looking at eschatology and the theology in the Bible pertaining to the final events of human history, its truths are meant to comfort Christians and meant to be a warning to unbelievers. Now look at the chronology on the screen. We're living in the church age. The next thing that will happen, we've talked about this the last few weeks, is notice the rapture, and I've got an up sign. I want you to associate the rapture with us going to meet Christ in the air and being taken to his Father's house. He takes out everyone who's ever believed, resurrects their bodies, and then the wrath begins, 7-year tribulation. At the end of the tribulation period is the second coming. It's Christ coming down to earth with his armies, fighting in the Battle of Armageddon. So we're in the church age right now, and today we're going to look at the tribulation period. Now, do not get discouraged, because we're going to cover a ton of material, but I just can't find anything I want to throw out. So we're not going to stop and study any one passage. We can't turn to all these passages. Much of eschatology is a piecing of all the prophecies as rightly dividing the word, all the things Jesus said, all the doctrine taught in the New Testament epistles, putting all those together and then piecing them out. So today we're going to look at the tribulation. It's going to be fast and furious. Let's start with the definition. The tribulation is a period of 7 years when God's judgment on unbelieving man will be intense and fulfilled. It will be specifically related to Israel, but will include all the earth. After the rapture, God's going to pour out his wrath on all who've rejected the price God paid to send his son, Jesus, to die. And yet, even in this time of wrath, where God is judging the world before the millennial kingdom is set up, he's still going to give one last chance before eternity for people to be saved. Look at some of the other names for the tribulation. It's called by a lot of names, descriptive names in the Bible. It's Daniel's 70th week. Oh, we've looked at Daniel's 70 weeks. Those are so key. The first 69 have been fulfilled. The first 483 years of those, if you count from the time Daniel prophesied, 483 years, that's exactly when Jesus died. It said in the 69th week that the Messiah would be cut off or crucified. The 70th week is that final 7-year period. Daniel didn't realize there would be a gap in there, church age, but it's this last 7-year tribulation period. And Daniel's 70th week is a fulfillment of Israel's prophecies and when they will believe as a nation. Notice it's also called the time of Jacob's trouble in Jeremiah 30. That means it'll be a very, very difficult time for Israel. It's called the day of the Lord in the Bible. It's prophesied time when God would judge Israel and unbelieving nations for their pride before Jesus establishes his millennial kingdom on earth. Look at 1 Thessalonians 5. 2 and 3. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come, just like a thief in the night. When they say peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, like labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. Man's pride will be judged during the tribulation. Idolatry will be done away with. It's a time of judgment and death and destruction. It will be 7 years like nothing that has ever been seen on this planet Earth. And yet it will offer one last opportunity for hearts to believe, submit, and be saved. Some other names are given all through Scripture. I don't have time to give all of them, but let me just give 3 from Isaiah and then 3 from Zephaniah. Isaiah calls the tribulation period the indignation. He calls it the overflowing scourge. He calls it the day of vengeance. Zephaniah calls the tribulation the day of wrath, the day of darkness, and the day of alarm. In the New Testament, the tribulation period is called the hour of trial, the wrath to come, and the hour of judgment. Now look when the tribulation begins and ends. It begins with the signing of a peace treaty with Israel, according to Daniel 9:27, and it's going to end with the Battle of Armageddon and Christ's victory. You can look up those verses and read about those later. That leads to a second thing I want to emphasize that is associated with the tribulation period, and that's God's judgments. During the seven-year tribulation, God will execute three different phases of judgments. In each phase, there will be seven judgments in each of the three phases, so 21 total. The three phases are the seal judgments, the trumpet judgments, and the bowl judgments. Look at the first phase. Revelation 5 indicates the opening of each seal in the seven-sealed scroll reveals God's authority and his ownership of the planet. You can see where these are talked about in Revelation 6 through 8. Remember in Revelation 5, the Apostle John has been taken up to heaven and given a vision of this time. And in heaven, the question is asked, who is worthy to go up to the throne and take the seal closed with seven seals? God on his holy throne is holding this seal. Who has the authority, who has the ownership to take this seal and begin to execute in the name of God his wrath on the earth? No one qualified at first, and John wept. He was very disturbed. And then it says the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, the Lamb of God stepped forward. Jesus had the authority, and he stepped forward and took the scroll, and he opens it and breaks one scroll at a time, seven scrolls, seven judgments. Look at the next judgments, the trumpets. The trumpets signal a special announcement or the advent of a major event. These seven judgments are all administered by angels from God in heaven to man on earth. Certainly the sound of trumpets in ancient times always signified a major event or happening taking place. And as each of these are sounded, there are special angels who administer these judgments. Now, these are not from nature. They're administered from angels coming out of heaven to clearly indicate that these are directly from God. And many of the judgments that are in the trumpet judgments are similar to the 10 plagues that took place in Egypt in Exodus chapters 7 through 11. That leads to the last judgments. The bowl or vial judgments are the most intense and severe, seeming to indicate God's wrath filling them to capacity. With the turning over the seven bowls comes the distributing of every last drop of God's wrath. These last seven judgments are absolutely brutal. And they're almost like a bowl where God's wrath has filled and filled and filled from man's rejection, his mockery, his evil, and they're just filled to the brim, and it literally visualizes the angels turning them over and every drop of God's wrath being poured out. And there are objects of wrath in these seven that reach out. We don't have time to go through all those. You can Google the judgments of God in the tribulation period, and very easily you can find what those are. That leads to the three major figures in the tribulation period. There's many figures, but the three main ones, the nation Israel. It's very easy to ask in the church age. We think everything in God's world is centered around churches and Christian. Israel was the wife of God in the Old Testament, just like believers in the New Testament are the bride of Christ. He wed himself to them. And they were unfaithful. Israel was an unfaithful wife. God said she harloted herself with other gods. But he shows all throughout the Old Testament that though Israel has failed and though there is discipline, he still has a deep love. He's faithful. He has a plan to ultimately redeem them. The Old Testament prophet Hosea was literally a visual. God told Hosea to marry a woman named Gomer, and that was the first problem. And Gomer was a prostitute, and this holy prophet of God, Hosea, marries her, and she stays with him a while, and then she goes back into harlotry. And God tells Hosea to go take her and bring her back home when she's at her lowest moment, a visual of what God would do with Israel. Look at the next major figure. The Antichrist is a coming world ruler who will oppose everything about God and his people. He'll rise as a political power who has worldwide influence, and he eventually will become a religious leader as well. He's called many titles in the Bible: the Prince Who Is to Come, the King of the North, the Man of Lawlessness, the Little Horn, and the Beast. He'll be empowered directly by Satan to offer the world literally a substitute for everything about Christ in his kingdom. And he'll imitate the reign of Christ in the kingdom, but it'll be unholy. That leads to the last major figures, and this is the Satanic Trinity. This is how he'll do this. This is how deeply Satan has desired his whole life to be like God. Much of what he does is a mockery and an imitation to do what God had perfectly done. And God has a holy Trinity: God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit. There's God, and the Son is Christ, and then the Holy Spirit. Well, look what Satan does. In the seven-year tribulation, he forms an unholy Trinity. Satan replaces God, the Antichrist takes the role of Jesus, and the false prophet lifts up Satan and the Antichrist and everything he does, just like the Holy Spirit does. So with that in mind, we're going to go through a chronological view, and I'm going to give you a ton of things. We're going to start at the beginning of tribulation. We're going to hit midpoint of tribulation. We're going to look at the second half and then the ending. We're going to hit all these events. You will have heard them if you've been a Christian and you've been in the Bible through the years. You probably recognize every one of these phrases, but we're going to put them in an order of how they happen in the tribulation. We don't have time to stop and study them. You'll have to look at those a little more later. Let's jump off at the beginning. Look at the beginning of the tribulation events. The Antichrist signs a covenant with Israel. The Bible says a single event, according to Daniel's 70 weeks, will set off the tribulation. And that is the offer of peace. Watch Israel. Israel is desperate for peace. The whole world is at odds, and when someone steps forward and brings peace, we've been trying to get peace between Israel and the Palestinians. It's not going to happen until the Antichrist does it. Notice the next thing that happens: the day of the Lord begins. This always refers in the Bible to a future event where God intervenes in order to bring his judgment on sin in the world. And yet, before destinies, even at this time, are sealed forever in eternity, he's going to give one last seven-year period in the midst of his wrath and his anger to be saved. Look at the next thing: the rise of the Antichrist. Early in the tribulation, the man of sin and lawlessness will grow more and more powerful as he leads the world into rebellion against God. Now, the New Testament teaches that sin and lawlessness are already at work, but he'll culminate it. And as we watch evil in the world get more and more profound, as we see things where we increasingly say, I can't believe I'm seeing this. I can't believe the evil of humanity and how bad things are and how quickly it's growing. That's exactly what the Antichrist will take, and he'll build an anti-God, one-world government, economy, and religion. The next thing that happens is the Jewish temple is rebuilt. It has to be built by the middle of tribulation in order for the Antichrist to desecrate it in the middle of the tribulation period, which will start the great tribulation, second 3.5 years. So you say, well, how's that going to be built so fast? If it started during tribulation, well, watch China. China has built entire hospitals over a period of a few weeks. Our ability to build, they could build that temple very, very quickly with all the world working together at that point. Then the first judgments of God, the seals are opened and judgment begins. In Revelation 5, the Lamb receives the seven sealed scroll, and these seven judgments are opened one seal at a time. In your outline, you'll see a blank. Fill in 144,000 there. That's 144,000 Jewish evangelists. These are actually 12,000 Jewish men from each tribe. There'll be 12,000 from the 12 tribes of Israel, and they will be evangelists. And these Jews are going to fulfill God's original plan and purpose for the Jews to be his evangelists. When God came to Israel, he didn't come for them to hoard salvation. He came to offer them love and for them to be evangelists, to offer that to the whole world, and they didn't do that. They didn't accept Jesus, but these 144,000 early in the tribulation will accept Christ as Lord and Savior and be witnesses as God had mandated to the Jews to be to the whole world. Revelation 7, 9 through 14 says they'll reap a huge harvest. Many, many people will be saved through them. Look at the next interesting people, God's two prophetic witnesses. These are two prophets who will preach about the one true God. They have astounding power. Miraculous power. Many expositors think this will be Moses and Elijah, and they will speak to the power of God and the words of God. That leads to the next set of judgments, the second phase of those. The trumpet judgments are sounded, and rather than turning to God, even through this second phase of judgment, most of the world and most hearts will be calloused and hardened even further. At the next point, religious Babylon dominates the world. Revelation 17 talks about religious Babylon. It's a perverted and unfaithful worldwide church. It's very blasphemous. It's literally visualized in the scriptures as a prostitute, conveying how unfaithful to God in every way it is. It's an organized religion that influences the entire world, and that puts us at the midpoint. First 3.5 years are over. We're at the midpoint of tribulation. Look what happens here. The Antichrist is wounded and seemingly resurrected. In Revelation 13, 1 through 3, talks about how the Antichrist will receive some kind of mortal head wound. It would have killed most people, but he miraculously will be healed by Satan. This supernatural event will contribute heavily to people worshiping him as God. They'll think he has supernatural power and godlike recovery. And with that in mind, look what happens next. The world church, the religious Babylon, is destroyed. As the Antichrist gets more and more power, he turns against the religious Babylon, the worldwide church. He and his 10 alliances, his 10 kings who are under his authority, will go in and they'll destroy and completely wipe out that worldwide church. Why? Because it's a blasphemous church, because he's going to take religious center stage at this point. The final world religion will worship the Antichrist and him alone. It'll be entirely built around him demanding the worship of every human being on earth. What about God's two prophets at midpoint? Look what happens to them. They're executed and resurrected. After 3.5 years of preaching God, the Antichrist kills the two prophets and he leaves them in the street. They ministered 3.5 years. They're left in the street 3.5 days. The world is so happy that God's prophets are killed that it'll be like Christmas. It says literally all over the world, as their bodies lay in the street, the images will be broadcast to everyone, and they literally will give and exchange gifts celebrating God's prophets. But after 3.5 days, those prophets are resurrected and they ascend to heaven. You can read about that in Revelation 11, 7 through 11. Look what happens next. The Antichrist breaks his covenant with Israel. First 3.5 years, he'd been a protector of Israel, but now he becomes their persecutor because he wants all religious power. He doesn't want Israel sacrificing in the temple or any attachment to anything but him. And notice the next event, the abomination of desolation occurs. You hear that title, Daniel 11:39 talks about that. 2 Thessalonians 2:4 refers to it. Matthew 24:15 all address the abomination of desolation. This is where the Antichrist goes in and desecrates the temple. And according to Isaiah 14:13-14 and Ezekiel 28:2-9, he literally sets himself up as God to be worshipped as God. Notice what happens next in this. The false prophet carries out his evil ministry. Revelation 13:13-15 speaks about the false prophet. It literally pictures him as a beast. And the Antichrist empowers the false prophet to do some miracles, lesser miracles than God's type miracles, but miracles nonetheless that people will embrace as coming literally from a god. There'll be a little bit, I want you to picture the magicians in Egypt. If you remember, early in the plagues, the Egyptians would come in and imitate those. But once it got to a certain point, they could no longer imitate those. And this is the same way. They'll be able to do some miracles, but not like the true God, Christ. Satan is cast out of heaven down to earth in Revelation 12, 13 through 17 here. And so look what happens next. The Jews flee and Satan sets out to destroy saints. God preserves a remnant of the Jews, but Jerusalem be ransacked. Many Jews will be overwhelmed. It'll be a horrible event. In Matthew 24, 15 through 21, when you read that passage, we've read it many times where Jesus warns of what to do in a certain time. He's talking there to the Jews about this event, and they will go back to this, the believing Jews, and they'll go back to the words of Jesus and Matthew during this time. And so what will they do? They'll flee. Now look what that leads us to, the second half of the Great Tribulation. We've kind of been in the middle point. We're moving to the last half. The second half is called the Great Tribulation because it gets way worse in the end. Look what happens next. All who receive the mark of the beast forfeit salvation. Revelation 13, 16 through 18 and 14, 9 through 10 indicate that the Antichrist and the false prophet will set up a system on earth where none can buy or sell unless they have the mark of the beast. Believers in the Lord Jesus will refuse the mark, because to receive the mark is to worship Him, to turn to Him for needs. Those who receive the mark, however, come under the judgment of God, and they have no more opportunity for salvation. That leads to the third phase of judgments. Look at the bowl judgments. They're poured out here. And as I stated earlier, these are the worst judgments. This will be a horrific time to be alive on earth. And yet, during this time, the gospel of the kingdom is proclaimed to the entire world. During this time, the angels will literally, Matthew 24, 14 refers to this, but in Revelation it says literally the angels will proclaim the gospel of the kingdom. This is not the gospel of salvation by grace that we live in the church. This is during the tribulation period. This is for saints who know they only have to make it a few more years before the kingdom is coming. And the gospel of the kingdom is saying if you will receive Christ, the Messiah, the Savior, then He will take you into His kingdom here in a few years when He sets His kingdom up. Because remember, in the tribulation period, you can count times. We can't count now. We're just waiting for a rapture. We don't know when it'll happen. But you can count the 7 years out, and so they'll know a kingdom is coming at the end. And that leads to the end of tribulation. Satan amasses a great army, and the Antichrist's allies assemble against Israel. Revelation chapter 16, verses 14 and 16 say that literally demonic spirits go out to the kings all over the world and incite them to join the Antichrist to attack and destroy the nation of Israel, which will be the ultimate mockery. Why does God sustain Israel? Because they're His glory, for His glory. Why does God protect Christians and sustain us? Because we're His glory. And what's interesting is the first thing that happens is a major loss for the Antichrist. Commercial Babylon is destroyed. Satan will have set up the Antichrist headquarters in Babylon. And the verses in Jeremiah 50 say that God will cause a force to attack Babylon in association with Armageddon. Isaiah 13 19 says Babylon will fall just like Sodom and Gomorrah when God overthrew them. But even the destruction of Antichrist's capital won't deter the Antichrist. He turns to Jerusalem. Jerusalem falls and is ravaged. Zechariah 12, 1 through 3 and 14, 2 says all the nations will gather against Israel. And in Revelation 12, 6 and 14, apparently the Jews that get out in time, they will flee to the desert region south. Notice that Antichrist and his armies move south against them, and it looks bad, but here's where it's incredible. Jesus returns with his heavenly army. The same Jesus who ascended into the clouds and up into heaven in Acts 1:9-11 will come through the clouds again, down to earth, the second coming. It'll involve a physical, visible, bodily return to the glorified Jesus. Makes you want to shout, doesn't it? Jesus achieves instant victory, and he ascends the Mount of Olives. The Mount of Olives was all over the Bible. Jesus wept over Jerusalem during his triumphal entry. It was on the Mount of Olives that he overlooked the city of Jerusalem, and he knew that they would reject him, and he wept from the Mount of Olives. It's the Mount of Olives where the Garden of Gethsemane is, where Jesus prayed on the night that he was to be betrayed. Jesus blessed his disciples and ascended from the Mount of Olives after he finished finished on earth in his first coming. And after he finishes here in his second coming, he's going to victoriously march up the Mount of Olives. The tribulation is the wrath of God, all who reject God's Son, Jesus, and his offer of forgiveness through death on the cross. God has offered salvation at Calvary. The penalty for our sin is paid. Scripture says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. The scriptures say that all who believe in Jesus Christ will be saved, and Jews who accept Jesus Christ today will be raptured with the rest of believers. They won't go through this, but most Jews have still not quite recognized that Jesus was their Messiah. And like Gentile Christians who believe, Jewish Christians will be raptured out before the tribulation. The cross is our salvation. It's our payment for sin. God desires that all would be saved. But he is holy, and he will punish. He did not send his son and watch his son beaten and his eyebrows and beard plucked out and spat upon and hit and mocked. He did not send his son to die on the cross and give his body and blood and then give a pass to someone because they want to come to God some other way. Jesus is the only means to true salvation. And to accept Jesus Christ is to be spared from the wrath of God during tribulation. Future things in the Bible are meant to agitate. They're meant to disturb. They're meant to create fear and to motivate an unbeliever to response. Because deep down in your heart, maybe someone today is listening to this and they know this is true. But in the same way, studies like this greatly encourage believers. Because this world is the closest taste of hell we'll ever know. It's miserable compared to the justice, love, mercy, grace, kingdom of Christ. And we are awaiting him to come take us, that where he is we'll be also. So it encourages us. May you come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. You can call our church and we'll walk you through that. God bless you.